celebrating our 50th wedding anniversary. We came home Wednesday, and she left me on Thursday.
Oh. Atta girl.
She's up in Arcadia dog sitting. But we did sign up for another 50 years. I want you to know that. I'm sitting there in the hills of East Tennessee, Tuesday evening, 7:35, and I look at the dashboard on the car, and it's 95 degrees. It was hotter there than it was here. I was talking to one of our friends in Minnesota this week. It was 95 degrees in Minnesota this week, and they don't have air conditioning where they are. Guess what? This ain't such a bad place to be. And I'm glad that summer is officially here now. We passed the summer solstice this week, so things will begin to cool off. It will be extremely hot and extremely humid on the parking lot at 3:30 tomorrow afternoon. And in spite of the heat and the humidity, there will be dozens of people lined up to get food from Meals of Hope. Volunteers are still needed. Please sign up in Kemp Hall after the service. And don't forget to wear your name tag. Also, don't forget to stay hydrated. Drink lots of water if you're going to work for Meals of Hope. We don't want any of our folks getting sick, getting heat exhaustion while working for the Lord in this particular ministry. So take care of yourselves and take care of others. Okay, the bookmarks in the pews are a reminder. If you have given online, you can drop that in the plate. And it says, I gave. And if you'd like to use your phone to make a contribution to the church, code to scan is on the other side. The upper room devotionals for the next quarter are now available in the narthex. Please leave your donation to defray the cost of these in the basket that is provided. Bill Moyer, come on down and join me here at the front of the church. And Jared, come up here, please. One of the things that I'm proudest of Lady Presbyterian Church is your support for the Pam Florida Challenge. Jerry, tell them what Pam Florida Challenge does.
We at Pam Florida Challenge, with your help and blessings, provide weekend backpack meals for 2,800 children all throughout Florida in 10 counties, and specifically your congregation supports the children at Laley Elementary School, so thank you for that.
Thank you, Jerry. Now, a couple of months ago, you had a bike ride. And Bill Moyer, unbeknownst to me, postponed the surgery on his knee so that he could participate in that bike ride. Did you know that?
No.
To sign up to ride 200 miles is enough, but to do it postponing knee surgery, that goes beyond sacrifice and into real service. And Bill, Lady Presbyterian Church is donating to Pan Florida $2,050 in your name for your service on the bike ride. And I'm going to hand you this check and let you hand it to Jerry.
Just a Group D, which is the group we call the Kickstand Group. And these are people like you and I, the regular riders. They're not the pro girls who finished 5 hours ahead of the rest of the group. And around 5 o'clock in the evening, I think it started pouring rain. And the facility where we were staying for the overnight, a nice Nazarene camp center in Lake Placid, was struck by lightning and we had lost power. So we sent a rescue car out to get Bill and his group and they refused to come in. We had a group with extra bicycles, so they were changing out equipment. They had 4 or 5 extra bicycles. They had a lot of breakdowns, and it's the group with the biggest heart, and you guys have a lot of heart to help us feed hungry kids, so thank you.
Now, I've discovered there's also a 10-mile bike ride.
That's right.
And that's just riding around the park?
Yes.
I'm going to sign Reno Franks up. He'll only be 91 then.
Wonderful.
Okay? This is what we do as a church. When we pool our resources, when we put our funds and our fun together. And Bill, thank you and God bless you for representing Layley Church so well.
Thank you so much.
And Jerry, thank you for all that Pat Farnes got.
Thank you so much.
Do you need to say anything else? No, I'm just kidding. All right. Thank you. God bless you.
Thank you. Mary Stewart, Laura Ferranti, Wendy Smith, Jay De La Paz, Nancy Copeland, who's not here with us, she's up north, and Pat Markham. And Sherry Millison and Linda Mayhall have been teaching in our program. I can't thank them enough for all they've done for our program. If we didn't have them, our program would not exist. So I thank you from the bottom of my heart. Linda Mayhall has helped since the beginning of working with Mia. She has not been feeling well, so she should really be in our prayers. So she's not with us today. Sherry has been a tremendous help to me, taking over and teaching. So Sherry, could you come up, please? And Mia. Mia has been attending our Sunday school at Lely from the age of 4. She's now 8 years old. We have watched Mia grow, all of us here, physically and spiritually. She has developed a faith and a belief in our Lord Jesus over the years. We are extremely proud of her. Each week, Mia reads our scripture lesson from our church Bible. Now that Mia has become a very confident reader and will be entering third grade, we would like to present her with her very own Bible and a case to carry. Mia, this Bible is for you to cherish forever. I hope this Bible will travel with you throughout your life, especially each Sunday, as we continue our faith journey together at Lely Presbyterian Church. And Leo, yeah. Leo is now, has graduated, and he now attends church school lessons with us.
Thank you, Gail. I should have brought my Bible from my office with me this morning. I meant to and I forgot it. I've got an old Bible. The cover on it's scratched and some of the pages in it are torn. And it's got a date of November of 1955 in it. I was 9 years old. In November of 1955. And that Bible was given to me by the church that I grew up in. And I've still got it. And my hope and my prayer for you, Mia, is when you're as old as I am, that you'll still have that Bible and that it will have meant as much to you and done as much for you in those years as mine has for me. Let's pray. Oh, Lord our God, we thank you for your word, the Bible, that is a lamp unto our feet and a guide unto our pathways. May Mia and Leo always be guided by your word. In the name of the living word, Jesus Christ, we pray. And now let all God's children say,
Amen.
I want to say a special word before we go any further with our call to worship. insurance to cover that. I'm hoping it's a minor repair. I'm hoping we don't have to replace the organ. A couple of years ago, somebody gave Vanderbilt Presbyterian Church $2 million to put a new pipe organ in their sanctuary. I promise you, if you want to give this church $2 million, we'll do more than a pipe organ. Gives new meaning to the words organ donor, doesn't it? Oh, well. Enough foolishness. Let all who are able stand for the call of worship. Give thanks to the Lord, for God is good.
God's steadfast love endures forever.
Let the redeemed of the Lord rejoice. Let us worship God with the hymn found on page 5. Holy, holy, holy. saving grace of God and ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. In the name of Jesus, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Cleo Reeves, who normally is at Laley Palms, fell and fractured her hip this week. And Cleo had surgery and is a patient on the fifth floor at NCH downtown. I was kidding with her daughter Sharon this week, telling her to be sure to tell Cleo that she'd now been added to our list of fallen women. We need to keep all these folks in our prayers. Their needs are great, and they are dear, each one, to all of us, and to their families, and to their friends. And I would ask for your prayers as well for a couple of members of my wife's family. Seems as though her whole family is falling apart. Her nephew, who's 49 years old, managed to detach a muscle from his hip and had to have surgery for the reattachment of that. Her brother, who is, how old is Vaughn? I guess Vaughn is 60, will be 67 next month, or the month after that. Vaughn has been told by his nephrologist that he either needs a kidney transplant or to get on the list either for kidney transplant or for dialysis. And he was rejected at Vanderbilt Hospital for their kidney transplant program this week. And of course her niece, Piper Montana Smith, continues to suffer the long-term effects of Crohn's disease. Dear friends, if someone gave me a choice between a diagnosis of Crohn's and cancer, I'd take cancer every time, because cancer can be cured. Crohn's, you don't die from it, but you have to live with it, and it's terrible. Please keep them in your prayers as well. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, in whom we live and move and have our being, from whom we come and to whom we shall surely someday return, we lift up our hearts in prayer, praying for those we love, and praying for those we know, and praying for those we don't know, and praying for all your people who suffer, for those who are recovering from falls, from broken appendages. We pray your blessings, we pray your healing. Those undergoing physical therapy and chemotherapy and radiation treatment. We pray especially for Tom Stewart as he begins his radiation treatments this week. We lift them up to you, O Lord, for each one who continues to fight the battle against age, against disease, against infirmity, against cancer, against dementia. For each one, we pray your special blessing. We pray your blessings today, too, for those who are working, for the clerk in the grocery store, for the toll taker on the turnpike, law enforcement, fire protection, emergency medical services, the Department of Corrections, our soldiers, our sailors, our airmen, our Marines, our Coast Guardsmen, our Border Patrol, each one who keeps us free and keeps us safe, we pray your blessings. For the President, the Congress, the Governor, the Legislature, the Mayor, the City Council, the County Commission, for all who have been elected to serve your people, we pray that they may do just that. They may put aside hidden agendas and special interests and seek your will in all things and do that which is just and that which is righteous. Lord, we pray for peace in our world, not just the peace which comes from no war, but the peace and prosperity that comes from your shalom, your irene, your wholeness. Hear our prayers, O God, for we make them now and always, in the name of the one who taught us when we pray to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Thank you.
gifts we offer as a sign of your great love for the world, so that all may know and share the abundance of your grace. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Please remain standing. Turn to the last page of your bulletin, page 8, as we sing We the Garden together. Let's sing together.
I come to the garden. Hospital for their kidney transplant program this week.
And of course, her niece, Piper Montana Smith, continues to suffer the long-term effects of Crohn's disease. Dear friends, if someone gave me a choice between a diagnosis of Crohn's and cancer, I'd take cancer every time, because cancer can be cured. Crohn's, you don't die from it, but you have to live with it, and it's terrible. Please keep them in your prayers as well. Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, in whom we live and move and have our being, from whom we come and to whom we shall surely someday return, we lift up our hearts in prayer, praying for those we love, and praying for those we know, and praying for those we don't know, and praying for all your people who suffer, for those who are recovering from falls, for broken appendages. We pray your blessings, we pray your healing. For those undergoing physical therapy and chemotherapy and radiation treatment, we pray especially for Tom Stewart as he begins his radiation treatments this week. We lift them up to you, O Lord, for each one who continues to fight the battle against age, against disease, against infirmity, against cancer, against dementia. For each one, we pray your special blessing. We pray your blessings today, too, for those who are working, for the clerk in the grocery store, for the toll taker on the turnpike, law enforcement, fire protection, emergency medical services, the Department of Corrections, our soldiers, our sailors, our airmen, our Marines, our Coast Guardsmen, our Border Patrol, each one who keeps us free and keeps us safe, we pray your blessings. For the President, the Congress, the Governor, the Legislature, the Mayor, the City Council, the County Commission, for all who have been elected to serve your people, we pray that they may do just that, that they may put aside hidden agendas and special interests and seek your will in all things and do that which is just and that which is righteous. Lord, we pray for peace in our world, not just the peace which comes from no war, but the peace and prosperity that comes from your shalom, your irene, your wholeness. Hear our prayers, O God, for we make them now and always in the name of the one who taught us when we pray to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, to present yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. Let us offer our lives to the Lord, along with our tithes and our offerings.
Thank you.
offer is a sign of your great love for the world, so that all may know and share the abundance of your grace. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Please remain standing. Turn to the last page of your bulletin, page 8, as we sing We the Garden together. Sing together.
I come to the coffin. Said to him, "Teacher,
He said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you, God.
Someplace in a file, there's an old translation of Mark's Gospel, the Tabman version. I preached on this particular text, a sermon that I wrote for that class. I preached it in the church where I served as student assistant in downtown Louisville, Kentucky. And then a year or so later, I preached it in the church in the tiny town of Perryville, Kentucky, where I was student supply pastor for my final 2 years of seminary. When I was being examined for ordination after I graduated from seminary, I had to preach a sermon before the Presbytery of St. Andrew, located in Mississippi. And for some reason, I chose this text for that sermon. But the sermon that I will preach to you this morning is not that sermon. It may be a better sermon. It may be worse. That first sermon may have been the best because it was filled with the fresh insights of one just learning how to explore the Bible in its original languages, filled with references to the subtleties of Greek grammar. But I've learned over the years people don't care a whole lot for the subtleties of Greek grammar. This morning's sermon is preached 4 days after the 47th anniversary of my ordination to the gospel ministry. It's influenced by a half a century of storms, of wind and rain, if not the sea, of the storms of life and the storms of nature that have rocked the world in which I have now done ministry for half a century. But enough preamble, let's get to the story. Jesus had spent the day teaching in parables, and he was exhausted mentally and physically. To escape the crowds, as he often did, he put out into the Sea of Galilee, which is also known as Lake Gennesaret and the Sea of Tiberias. He put out into this long, narrow body of water, surrounded by rough terrain on both sides. When the wind whips through that valley, the water is troubled, and the waves that in a broader ocean would dissipate bounce off of each other and the shores and come back to rock one's boat yet again. Now, at least seven of the men in the boat with Jesus that day were fishermen. You'd think they'd be used to storms at sea. But no, the fishermen of the Sea of Galilee seldom ventured out into the middle of that body of water. They seldom crossed the sea to the other side. They fished the waters near the shore. And when a storm arose, they beached their boats and waited it out. Those fishermen and the rest of the disciples were frightened. But Jesus slept on, comfortable on a cushion in the back of the boat. When they woke him up, they asked him if he didn't care that they were perishing. What a question to ask Jesus. And yet, how many of us, in fear, in despair, when the storms of life assail us, when a loved one dies, or a financial disaster befalls us, or a relationship ends badly, or a major illness strikes, or an accident happens, how many of us would cry out to God, God, don't you even care? The psalmist uttered those words in Psalm 22. The same words that Jesus cried out from the cross. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? How many of us felt God forsaken at one time or another? And the words of Jesus rolled out through nearly 2,000 years. Why are you afraid? Do you still not have faith? But before he said those words, he had said to the wind and the sea, peace. Be still. And instantly the wind died and the waves subsided and a great calm came over the waters. Faith in God, faith in Jesus Christ allows us to sleep through the storm. There's a story about a farmer who was hiring a hand who had worked for a neighbor who didn't need his help anymore. When asked for a reference, the neighboring farmer simply replied, well, he can sleep through a storm. The new employer really didn't understand what this meant, but he hired the fellow anyway. When a windstorm arose a few weeks later, the farmer went out to check on things. All the equipment was safely parked. All the livestock was in their stalls. The doors of the hayloft were closed and latched, and the farmhand was sound asleep in his quarters. With everything taken care of, he could sleep through the storm. Last year, when Hurricane Irma swept through our part of the Sunshine State, Polly and I moved everything in our apartment to above the predicted storm surge line. We figured out the elevation on our apartment, 8 feet. And the storm surge was supposed to get to 9 feet. So we put everything up at least a foot off the floor that we could. And then we evacuated to Arcadia. Really smart, right up the path of the storm. When our friend Kay called and said she'd been called into work at the hospital, we moved to her house to dog sit during the storm. That's where Polly is today, dog sitting for Kay. Polly and the dog spent the night on a blanket in the hallway listening to the storm and the rain. I was on the king-size bed sleeping through the storm. I slept through Hurricane Irma. Everything at Kay's house and at our little ranch was secure. Our son had secured his place and evacuated with his family to Georgia. But that is not why I could sleep through the storm. I could sleep through the storm because I believed the first line of our brief statement of faith as Presbyterians. It goes like this. In life and in death, we belong to God. I believe that. And I believe the last line, which says that nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. I may have told you about George Minitree before. I'm going to tell you about George again. George was a deacon in the church in which I was ordained 47 years ago this week. A good man. Worked at the Walker Manufacturing Muffler Plant there in Aberdeen, Mississippi. They made those mufflers with asbestos. He developed mesothelioma, lung cancer. The fact that he smoked two packs of Chesterfields a day probably didn't help. In his final days, he was in the hospital there. George, in addition to being a deacon in the church, sang in the choir, had a wonderful baritone voice. Sang in the choir, and as his life dwindled down to the end, the pastor suggested that the choir might go by after church on Sunday and sing to George. So every Sunday, members of the choir would gather around George's bed in his hospital room, and they'd sing a hymn or maybe the anthem of the morning if it was one they could follow without accompaniment. And on the last Sunday of his life, he gathered around his bed and they sang that old hymn. It goes, "Be not dismayed, whate'er betide. God will take care of you." When he got to the final course, somewhere deep down within those ravaged lungs, George found enough breath to raise his voice and join with him. "God will take care of you. God will take care of you." And then he took one more breath and he died. Who is this? The disciple asked that even the winds and the wave obey him. Who is this? Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for our sins and is risen from the dead for our hope. And who is this who is with us through all the storms of life, even if it seems like he has forsaken us, forgotten us, is asleep in the back of the boat? Once we've placed our faith, our trust in him, we have nothing to fear in this life or in the life to come. God will take care of you. We can sleep through the storms. Who is this? This is the Savior of the world, the answer to our prayers, the fulfillment of our hopes, the conqueror of fear and sin and death. This is Jesus, and to him be the power, the dominion, and the glory and the praise in the church and in the world, now and forevermore. Amen and amen. Let us stand and affirm our faith in the use of the apostle. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and was buried. He ascended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From then
times he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Our closing hymn is found on pages 6 and 7. He lives. Continue to abide in your hearts and minds and lives.